Consider is part two, and this is debate will be on clauses 47 to 53 and schedules 2 and 3. Does any member want to take the call? I call Phil Twyford.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Much of what is contained in schedule 1 of the bill pertains to what goes into the long-term plan, and that I think is something, sir, that's worth discussing. And it brings us back to the question of community outcomes, which we can see on page 26 of the the bill, part one. It's the community outcomes is obviously the key thing that should be contained in the long-term plan. They are, in fact, the high-level goals. And I just want to reiterate the concern that we've already expressed this morning about what this bill does to the whole process around community outcomes. It takes away the requirement that councils must consult their citizens in the development of these high-level goals, and undermines the very democratic basis of the whole structure of having long-term plans, and I think that's a real shame, sir. And as well as taking away the requirement for councils to consult their citizens, it also restricts the definition of community outcomes, I think, far too narrowly. And it says that community outcomes, as the, you know, the high-level goals of the long-term plan, can only be the things that the council itself can deliver. Setting aside then any number of important issues that communities feel strongly about, it could be boy races, it could be alcohol, it could be the effect of gambling in the community. None of these things local councils themselves completely control. And it requires leadership, it requires advocacy and coordination. And it's perfectly legitimate for communities to ask their councils and their elected representatives in local government to take up these matters. And it's perfectly reasonable, sir, that these issues could be identified as community outcomes. The other thing that I wanted to say about the long-term plan in relation to Schedule 1 is that, you know, the kinds of things that go into the long-term plan are any substantial change in the level of service that's being provided, the sale or construction or replacement of an asset. These things are typically the kinds of things that go into the long-term plan, and yet this bill, what this bill does is that it removes the obligation of councils to consult their people, their communities, on these kinds of issues. And I want to give one example, sir, that happened recently in Auckland. The council, well-meaning, wanting to promote public transport and bus patronage, proposed a four-lane highway to run down Dominion Road, one of the main arterial routes on the Auckland Isthmus. And this was to basically provide faster bus passage through and in and out of the central city. The impact of that proposal, sir, when the council started to consult the community, the impact was that the local community was horrified. Dominion Road's home to a couple of wonderful urban villages that with a really vibrant shopping communities, a lot of pedestrian traffic, fantastic local restaurants, a lot of new migrant communities served, particularly Chinese communities, have made Dominion Road their home. It's a really great part of Auckland. And the effect of the council's proposal to put a four-lane highway and no parking down either side of Dominion Road for several kilometres would have been a disaster for these vibrant urban villages. Now, it was only the requirement on the council to consult on this matter that would have gone into the long-term plan. It was only the requirement to consult their community thoroughly that allowed what was a well-meaning but misconceived transport plan to be debated and discussed. And ultimately, sir, it was thrown out. And that is a vindication of the kind of community consultation processes that this bill is weakening and undermining. And a result of the long-term plan that's set out here in Schedule 1 of the bill, sir, it's going to be greatly weakened.